Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
I have to wait, so. Hello, who am I? So if you need ever, if I ever went to write a mail to me, this is my mail address. I really love the new top level domain. And in my actual life, I'm a professional stock photo model, but Brunei needs more cybersecurity personnel, but I didn't get any job offer from Brunei yet. So if anybody from Brunei is here, this is my mail address, right? So. Who am I actually? I'm a contributor to OnCloud. I'm contributing to it since 2012. I'm employed since 2014 and I'm the number 4 contributor meanwhile, which means I have fixed a lot of stuff, right? And before I go a little bit into what is OnCloud actually and what we did at OnCloud, let's first look a little bit about at what is the good side and the bad side of the cloud. So cloud sounds awesome. Cloud is awesome. Everybody loves cloud. So there is something we call the awesomeness of the cloud. If you talk about the cloud, you have your data everywhere. You can go to another country, use another laptop, have your data, right? Your data is nearly backed up online, you don't need to do anything. That's pretty cool, and it's all pretty much cheap. Nobody is gonna charge you for it lots of money, right? So, if you talk about cloud, you always need to think about this great image from the FSFE. There is no cloud, there are just other people's computers, and that's fair enough. But do you really know what other people do with your data on other people's computer? Well, they tell you they won't do anything bad with you, and that's fair enough, and you can believe it, that's fair enough. You may even live with the idea, you might even be okay with the idea others control your data. That's the choice of everybody. But with OnCloud, you basically had the idea to take back your data. So take back your data is store the data where you want. Now a little sales pitch. What is OnCloud? It's a single share solution. The elevator pitch is like, it's like Dropbox, but open source, installed on your own server. We have meanwhile over 8 million users worldwide. We don't know the actual number because it's just the software that you install, right? And it has pretty much all the functionality you know from other products. It has a synchronization client for Android, iOS, Mac, Linux, Windows, web interface. That sounds pretty good, but that's not how we have started. So how we have started was pretty much different. So when we started, it looked like this, right? And it's an okay interface. You were able to upload files. You were able to delete files. But that's pretty much it. And we need to look back a little bit to reflect what we have done in security back then and what we have to do now. So the project has grown immensely over time. We have started with like 2 to 4 or 5 contributors. Nowadays we have over 500 contributors in total that have contributed. We have like, I think it are 70 different contributors a month. That's pretty okay-ish. Companies actually started to use the solution because there was the idea, Dropbox is great, I love Dropbox, but it's not really compliant with any data protection laws in Europe, right? So that's actually why they started to use it. And meanwhile, even universities started to use it. We have some prominent examples, for example, here we have the Vatican and the Deutsche Bahn, both not really, well, some people like them, some others not, right? And on the education side, we have, for example, the CERN and lots of universities worldwide, and they actually love the idea that you can share files over different instances. So you can share, as a student at ETH Zurich, you can share data with somebody at the University of Vienna. Pretty easy. And that sounds pretty cool, but we also need to look back at what was the security at the start. So when we started, it was like one person who had the idea of, I want to make the world a little bit better, everybody should install the server on their own, right? And so the idea, the security at the start was basically, there was a Git repository, everybody could push directly to it. You just needed push permissions, which were pretty easy to get actually. There was no formal code review process, so everybody could push code as they like. There was no static source code analysis, nor manual security testing, or dedicated security personnel, and to say it a little bit evil, it's probably the same as still in many companies today, right? I mean, we all know how it is in many companies. So, that sounds actually pretty terrible, I know this. And we actually have been thinking, what do we need to do to make it better, or at least a little bit better, right? The first thing that we actually have done is introduce pull request reviews, and people are always like, what, that's so, that's a default, you need to do this, and right, you need to do this. And we introduced it a little bit too late, but we have it nowadays, so we use GitHub, and we have the policy that we have component owners and two other persons need to review this source code. And I will show some statistics later how this has affected the amount of vulnerabilities tests gone down missing. And some nice quote about pull request reviews is the following one. Ask programmers to review 10 lines of code, they will find 10 issues. Ask them to do 500 lines of code, and they will find 500 issues. And then the same looks good. Yeah, right. So, it's actually true, because there are many pull requests which have like 1,000 lines of code changes, and people after 20 seconds, after it has been submitted, there is a plus one mehr. Did we look at it? So you really enforce it, right? Tell the people, hey, maybe make 20 small ones instead of one with 2 billion lines of code, yeah. So, what we also do now is regular code reviews for security issues. That's something you can pretty easily integrate into any quality assurance process. So what we have for each component, we have created a list of acceptance criteria, like this application should probably check the permissions of the user before it allows editing the file, right? And then there is some state like pass or fail, and if it fails, it fails. This is a pretty good thing to do, especially if you involve the developer itself, because before developers don't really tend to think a lot about what is required to make the software secure, what edge cases are there, but if you force them to come up with a threat model, they actually think about what could go wrong. That's good stuff. Automatic static analysis is something that I also can recommend, right? We use, for example, Veracode, and that's a closed-door software as a service, which basically points out potential dangerous usages of PHP functions. We have written in PHP in the server side, and then we can see the stack trace and look whether this is a legitimate issue or whether this is a false positive. This is pretty good to do. It costs a lot of time, so if you do something like this on a regular basis, you need probably like one dedicated person to look at it for a week, for each release. That's quite the time consuming. And now comes some marketing bingo again. So customers to perform security tests, we nowadays do have customers, and we try to follow industry best practice for security testing. I love this term because there is no actual definition of what is industry best practice. And while there are some ISOs, these ISOs are like, you should have a security at company.com address, and it would be great if you also respond to these mails, right? But nobody knows this if they don't have read this, so pretty easy to fulfill them. What we do is we are very extensive about the security issues we have found. We do a full-blown advisory, including the CVE, vulnerability description, root cause analysis, and stuff like this. Pretty much standard in many projects nowadays, not in all, unfortunately. So we also do lots of security hardenings. This is just one example what we have added in a recent release. And why do I show this? It's a little bit because of a topic that I will go in later. So if we talk about OwnCloud, there are basically two kinds of people, no three. There are the people that don't know OwnCloud, they are okay. Then there are the people that like OwnCloud, I like them. And then there are people that don't really like OwnCloud. Let's say they hate OwnCloud, and I don't hate them, I just don't like them as much as the good orders. So this is one example for haters gonna hate, right? Let's go with somebody who has congratulated us for our fifth birthday. Thank you very much, Andreas. Happy fifth birthday, OwnCloud. Here's 96 reasons to avoid you, with a link to the 96 security advisories that we have published. And that's fair enough. I mean, you can communicate something like this, but we also have found some statistics in the internet. And this one is actually true as well. So if you would forbid Internet Explorer, right, nobody would be murdered again. So what I'm going to show you with this is, if you take something like statistics, always look at it at least three times, right? So now I show my hopefully less fake statistics, right? There we go. These are the fixed vulnerabilities per year. You see, 2012 and 2013 is pretty much fucked up. You have like, I'm allowed to say this, right? I know, yeah. But we pay for bugs later, right? So actually, because we are becoming lazy, we don't fix any bugs anymore, as can be seen here. And this actually looks pretty promising. It goes down and we can discuss the reasons later, right? And if you look into who has found the vulnerabilities, it even looks a little bit better for us. So, who has found the vulnerabilities and how are we doing? This is the amount of security advisories that we, security patches that we have made, not necessarily the amount of the advisories, and who has reported them. So we have three different types of vulnerabilities: low, medium, critical. Low is anything you don't really have to worry about too much. Medium is you should better patch it, and critical is you better get up at night and apply the patch, right? So as you can see, most issues are nowadays found internally, which means that actually having code review processes helps, especially if you look into the data at years. So this is the severity by reporter in 2012. You see a lot of vulnerability reports, and for also externally quite some reports. If you go now into 2013, it looks a little bit less reports, but still a shocking high amount of external reports, right? Now 2014 looks way better. There are still critical issues, but they were all found internally, fixed, and so we have searched them on our own and fixed them. 2015, again, somewhat better, right? So, how have we done this? Actually, it has involved quite some refactoring and rewrite. So nowadays, security checks have to be disabled by default, has to be disabled by the developer, right? Previously, you always had to opt in for security check, like this controller needs to perform this and this security check. What we have nowadays is you need to opt out of a security check. So by default, all security checks are performed, and then you define something like, this is a public page, make it public, no authentication checks, and there's no cross-site check required at all. And it's much harder to, and much easier to forget something instead of if you have to write some exclusions. So way harder to fuck up. We have done some more stuff, so we use an internal file system, which is basically a wrapper around the storage we use. And they are not vulnerable against directory traversals anymore. Let me show you an example. So here you define the folder you want to change root into, and then you say, I want to fopen my file.txt, which will work. And what won't work is something like ./... myfile.txt. This makes it a little bit harder for developers because they need to come up with some workarounds around how can I go up a folder and stuff like this, but it's actually quite an interesting approach if you prevent some categories of vulnerabilities. You just need to teach them how to use it. And we also have enforced some security functionalities nowadays, like content security policy since 2013, which prevents the execution of inline JavaScript, so something like XSS is not a problem if you don't use enterprise-grade software from the house of Microsoft, because Internet Explorer don't perform any security checks yet on CSPs. We have also blacklisted potential dangerous PHP functions, so we have written a static source code analyzer on our own. It's well, not completely written on our own. We have taken some open source components, and then we look at the source code and be like, yeah, this is a potential insecure function. Maybe you want to use the other one. And this helps a lot because people don't know all the time what could be dangerous and what could not. But we all know security is hard, right? So this is a nice image of Michael Pollock. Michael Pollock is a great artist, and he had the idea of, I will give my images just a number. So this is number, I don't know, either 9, 12 or 2, yeah, a number. And anyways, he don't want to influence you with anything in advance. So you should find on your own what it is. So this could be like, for some it is a zebra, for others it's an elephant, and for others it's just a few lines. And with security it's the same. So if you have different people looking at your source codes, they will always look at it differently. So that's why we have introduced a bug bounty program, so that others can do our work, right? Because as we have heard before, we have found less bugs before. We use the HackerOne platform. HackerOne is a service as a service platform. You have basically the page online there, and security reporters can submit security reports there. And it has some advantages. It is used by other major vendors like Yahoo, Twitter, Adobe, or Dropbox. So there is already a huge community of, let's call them security researchers, in And they actually are on this platform and they can take a look at which company or which project is paying for security bugs. Just click on it, take a look at the projects and get paid. They are quite some great filtering tools and support, because if you launch a bug bounty program, you will get a huge amount of noise, some statistics later. And the payments are actually processed by HackerOne. So if you ever have the problem to find out how to pay money to Uganda, you don't have to, because they have to pay it in this country. Way easier this way. The platform is, one could call it a little bit a glorified issue tracker, right? There are open issues and closed issues, and this is a report. And there is a fancy functionality, it is called Hackbot. It basically looks at the security reports that have come into and correlates it with other security reports that other users of HackerOne have reported. And so I can, for example, see, somebody has reported something similar to Dropbox. Let me see how they have responded to it, which saves a lot of time if you know what it is about and others have done already some pre-triaging for you. With amount of the reports you are going to expect from a bug bounty program, you are going to get quite some reports, especially at the start. We got 45 reports a day, which is quite a lot to handle. And at the public launch, we got 30 reports, and now it's gone down to 1 to 2 reports a day or week. That's pretty much handleable. So if ever anybody of you ever wants to start a bug bounty program, expect to have a huge amount of reports in advance, and then it will go down. And if one looks at the amount of reports, I've told before, there's a huge amount of noise. So if you look at the amount of noise, we have 14% of valid issues. And then we have 68% of issues which are actually not valid, which is stuff like your usernames do allow dots in it. I don't know why this is an issue. If anybody knows, tell me later, please, right? So we have resolved 46 reports, and we have paid out $700 in bounties. So the three reports in scope, which means they were against our product, and there were 43 reports against our infrastructure, like you disclosed the server version in your Apache header. That's not good, so fix it. We fix it, and that's it then. The lessons learned from a bug bounty program is protect infrastructure against automated testing tools in advance, because people are going to test your website. And we had something up there which allowed you to contact our salespeople and stuff like this. And some of our business development representatives were not quite happy about 5,000 new customers called script all at once. So don't forget any contacts form and stuff like this. And the quality of reports differs hugely depending on the reporter. So I would say there are like 5 top performers, which I'm super nice to, and there are like 200 people who I don't really want to receive reports from, to be honest. And just be nice to the nice ones and be a little bit less nice to the less good ones, right? And there are likely no low-hanging fruits. If you think there are some, you can earn money, yeah, right? Just go to HackerOne.com/outcloud. But let's think a little bit about what went wrong, what could have been better with regard to what we have done with the security changes. So, first of all, pull request reviews came really, really late. We should have done them before. They would have prevented a lot of issues and ensure they actually get reviewed, because if only people file issues, file pull requests, the list is just going to get a huge bigger. This is cryptography. I'm not really a big fan of this topic. Well, I like cryptography, but in the past we had some encryption functionality which was not really top-notch. That's a nice word, yeah. And some people were actually blaming us for it, and fair enough, so we are working actively on changing this. We even paid out recently a $350 bounty for a small security issue in the encryption functionality, right? Openness in retrospective, this is a little bit controversial. So if I would do it again, publishing advice always, I would do it first when the software is secure. Again, enough, so otherwise you will get 300 people who blame you based on the amount of reports. Let me go shortly through this. You actually need to be aware that external companies and people will look at your product and they will find security issues. And thus is best to be proactive and have stuff fixed before. Bug bounties are a good addition. They are not a replacement. I would start with higher rewards though. And one small anecdote to the end here, do not trust reviews without checking them in detail. So we had a big customer of ours, which has performed a security check, and then they told us like, oh, we have found one security issue. So we actually had to go there because they didn't want to send us the information by mail. So when we got there, they actually told us, it's not one issue, it's 500 different issues, okay? So they showed us the 500 different issues and it were 500 hard-coded passwords. It turned out this was only the translation from the English term password to the German password and stuff like this. But because they were Americans, they probably didn't know their other languages. Otherwise, I couldn't explain this. So always think twice about stuff. And that's it. My time is over. So if you want to contribute, github.com/oncloud, hectorone.com/oncloud, or we have stickers in building K. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. We have 5 minutes for questions.
Is your bug bounty program ongoing, or is it just for releases?
It's ongoing. So we have started in August, and it's for all new releases. So we have say we support 4 old releases with patches, but we pay only for the latest ones. We don't have any budget limit. We have for critical bugs we pay $500 at the moment. We are considering going up to 1,000, but we don't have any limitations. Like we have as long as this one, right? Which hopefully is long.
More questions?